We are the Greater Washington Partnership panel discussion today, and we're very pleased to be here and very grateful for the invite to talk with you about the Greater Washington Partnership. It's such a great fit for UIDP because the Greater Washington Partnership is exactly what it the title indicates. It is a partnership across the DMV, as we call our regional area here. And in particular, we're going to focus on the Capital CoLab, one of the key developments in the Greater Washington Partnership that features industry and university collaborations. So I'm Catherine Russell. I'm the Associate Dean in the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences. I focus primarily on undergraduate education, and I'm very pleased to moderate this panel today and welcome our panelists. Today we have with us Chris Carlson, who is Director of University Recruiting and Relations at Northrop Grumman. Lindsay Johnson, who is the Director of Talent Initiatives at the Greater Washington Partnership. And Lynn Powell, who is the Director of the University Career Center here at the University of Maryland. And just as a brief overview, we have each been involved in the Greater Washington Partnership Capital CoLab, and I'm going to ask each of our panelists to describe a little bit more about the Greater Washington Partnership and Capital CoLab from their perspectives, starting with Chris as our industry representative from Northrop Grumman. I'm going to ask Chris to talk a little bit about pipeline workforce needs and how the Greater Washington Partnership Capital CoLab is aiming to help address the workforce needs and how universities and in fact other academic entities in the DMV are participating in this endeavor as partners. So Chris, over to you to start us off.
Absolutely. I think it's not just in the DMV, but I think across the country you're seeing kind of the great resignation and the tsunami of openings and opportunities. Unemployment's at 3%, I believe, in the DMV area and continuing to go down. There's a true need across industry to ensure that we're gonna have not only the people to do the job. It's not just, are they breathing? Okay, hire them. It's really, we need to look at, do they have the skills? Do they have the competencies? Are they fungible to address kind of the ever-changing environment that we're working within? And so one of the key things that we're looking at Northrop Grumman and several other companies that are part of the Greater Washington Partnership is the fact that this particular region is growing dramatically. I think the initial impetus for this was a very large company, I think, that was unmentioned in the last session, which I think I can mention, Amazon, was looking to potentially relocate one of its headquarters here and a major operation center. And what that really sparked was a dialogue around, do we even have enough qualified, skilled individuals to not only attract a major employer like Amazon, but to maintain the large employers that we already have in the DMV area? I mean, not only do you have the federal government, but you also have large organizations like Northrop Grumman. So I think the real driver here is kind of coming together and recognizing the fact that one individual company can't really build a workforce by itself. It has to be a collaborative effort with both academia as well as the public sector in many respects. So that really was the premier driver for what we're looking at here within the Greater Washington Partnership.
Thanks very much, Chris. Sure. Lindsay, representing the Greater Washington Partnership, can you tell us a little bit about the history of the Capital CoLab and about the knowledge, skills, and abilities that this coalition is looking for and how we're putting that all together in a package?
Yeah, absolutely. And everything Chris just said, if you zoom out, that's what we're hearing across lots of companies, and that was the impetus for Greater Washington Partnership to come together. We're a fairly new organization. We started in early 2017 around three key areas, inclusive economic growth in the region, regional mobility and infrastructure, and skills and talent. And the skills and talent division is the division that I work in, and the Capital CoLab was born out of that work. So in early 2018, we launched a meeting. This was right before I started working at the partnership, but there was a meeting with CEOs and university presidents from across the capital region, which our footprint we think about is Baltimore to Richmond. And they came together around some of those talent needs that you just described, Chris. Do we have the talent to fill the open positions now and in the future? Not so sure, and we needed a new way to think collectively across companies to make that impact and really think about the tech talent ecosystem at scale. And a few priorities emerged from that initial conversation that shaped the way Capital CoLab works today. The first was thinking about digital tech as a skill set that spanned across multiple industries, lots of different jobs, and was something that no matter what you studied, whether you were a university student or even at an associate's degree level or even as early as high school, there were lots of routes you could take and this would still be a relevant skill set. So thinking about data security, analysis, visualization. The second thing was to get started, build on the great momentum already happening within universities, which is why we started with them as our initial academic partners. Universities across our region are innovating new curriculum to respond to industry all the time, and with this greater collaboration across sectors, we could bring more transparency into tech needs as they change and deliver those more quickly to academic partners. And then the third thing was thinking about a way to consistently signal this skill set. So no matter which institution you graduated from, no matter which major you had, we had a more consistent signal back to employers that you as a student graduated with the skills that they were looking for. And so our first program with the Capital CoLab was the Digital Tech Credential, which embeds industry-aligned curriculum across our now 21 university partners, aligned to entry-level tech and tech-adjacent skills. And there are various course pathways you can take and various course pathways that universities have chosen to move forward with, which include our generalist credential, so thinking about preparing students for tech adjacent roles, and then more specialized curriculum in cybersecurity, data analytics, and machine learning. That again was our inaugural program. It's set the basis for how we think about IT pathways even earlier in the education spectrum, and we've made a lot of progress in 4 years, so I'm excited to share more about that with everyone.
Great, thank you very much. And Alin, as our director of our University Career Center here at Maryland and someone who has her finger on the pulse of the from the university side of these sorts of partnerships, tell us a little bit about the changing landscape and the value of these university and employer partnerships.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I think about from the student perspective, right? Our students are coming into higher education wanting an amazing experience. And we as career centers historically have been positioned as service providers, right? To be present when they need, when they realize, right? It might be a resume or a cover letter. That field of dreams model where if you build it, hopefully at some point they'll show up. And we know that didn't work. It hasn't worked. It hasn't met the needs that industry has demanded of us. And so what we've seen over time is this shift in how we as career centers and universities have operated in terms of really trying to embed career into curriculum. How do you create pathways kind of in the things that students know are already required to be thinking about who am I and what do I want to do? What are the skills and interests that I possess? How might I begin to learn to articulate that in a way that employer partners can see, hear, and understand? And how do we provide opportunities for connection and exposure so as students are going through those academic careers, they have opportunity to try things out, to figure out, is this a good fit, and to build upon what they're learning in the classroom. And so kind of what we've done over time is really kind of enhance those academic partnerships, really embedding opportunities for exposure and experiential learning into the classroom, and then deepening our relationships with employers. I think for so long we simply connected them to students at the point of graduation or internships, and we know so much more about their needs now and their desires to be educational partners with us, right? And really help kind of expose students to what industry looks like and what the needs are early, provide them opportunities for things like internships and or experiential learning, And then kind of create those pipelines to meet the needs that we know exist out in the marketplace. And so GWP was a welcome kind of invitation when they showed up at the Career Center to say, we want to bring together all three, right? The universities, the employers, and academic to kind of come together to have a robust conversation about how do we do this well for students as we move forward.
Yeah, thanks very much, Olivia. Did you want to add something, Chris?
I would just add that, really following on that experiential component, obviously, I'm not a social scientist myself, although I guess sort of, but everyone in the room from what I've gathered really is in that space, and I think it's really critical as you start to look at opportunities for students going even through the social sciences. Something like this is really incredibly helpful for those students to prepare them for what industry is really looking for. The generalist path and credential is specifically designed for those kind of positions that aren't necessarily for an engineer or computer scientist, but really can take into account the data analytics and other components of kind of that digital technology skill set that we need. I mean, as we look around us, enrollment is, I guess, has been reported as being down across the country overall. So for companies, it becomes even more critical as we look for building our next generation of employees to look at outside normal pipelines for us. So typically at a Northrop Grumman, we would hire, 85-90% of our hires being engineering majors. Yeah. And we hire them in mass. But as we start to realize that enrollment is starting to tick down in many areas, as we start to look at, having to reach back all the way to K through 12, which I know the CoLab does as well, to really start to encourage students. It's looking, how do you build that skill set? How do you make your talent acquisition? How do you make your hiring pipeline more focused around the skills and competencies versus around a major or a degree? And these particular digital credentials come in to be so relevant to what we're looking for. And it allows us to understand, well, who is going to be able to join our organization, move quickly and adapt to the technologies that we have, who understands the basics that we need in order to be successful in our organization. I think that's a major plus for everyone as we continue to go forward.
Chris, that brings us to a really good place. It might be helpful for us to describe in a little more detail how the Capital CoLab is communicating employer needs to universities and to students, the knowledge, skills, and abilities, the actual learning outcomes that were created by the Greater Washington Partnership Capital CoLab are pretty unique because they developed them as an industry and delivered them to universities in a way that we could digest and communicate to students. So you want to talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, sure. And we gather that data and communicate it out through a process we run each year called the Employer Signaling System. It starts with looking at labor market data on the capital region and what it's saying about high demand digital tech industries and occupations rather versus the industry, since an occupation can span many types of industries. Looking at that data, we can get a sense of the entry-level opportunities that offer a family-sustaining wage, and we use that as kind of the endpoint to how we think about skill building. So once we have those and we get a sense of the general categories that they fall under, maybe it's data analytics, cybersecurity, we then convene industry advisors now on a biannual basis to make sure that we understand within companies their specific entry-level hiring needs, and we can level set those to understand where the greatest need is across all of these companies. In that process, we get really, really granular into the knowledge, skills, and abilities, or KSAs, needed to make someone qualified for those entry-level roles. And for those in academia, what that means is we spell out really specifically what you need to know, for example, to develop a data visualization. So it isn't just saying data visualization is a skill you need, it really breaks it down. We also add a Bloom's taxonomy level. So across all of our university partners, there's an understanding of how deep this skill needs to go and what those expectations are at the entry level. So we pull the data, We convene industry subject matter experts to spell out those KSAs for us, and we communicate those to our university partners. If someone is not currently a university partner and wants to get involved, we ask that they map existing curricula to those KSAs just to show that it's covered, and oftentimes it is. Sometimes it's just a matter of repackaging existing courses in a minor or perhaps a concentration within a minor just to better reflect the skill sets as they're packaged in entry-level roles in the region. And we work with our partners through the career centers, through our University Leadership Council, which includes a lot of department deans and provosts, to make sure that that information is communicated out to students. And we also run student programming to support that work, to make sure that the end user of all this, the student, has an understanding of how they would then apply their skills in the classroom. And we have programming through industry panels. We do a credential month, so for anyone who's enrolled in this program in their university, we have some professional development activities. And so it all comes full circle, so by the time they graduate, ideally not only do they have the skills, but they have some professional experiences and understanding that they've built along those 4 years, or however long they're pursuing their undergraduate curriculum. So they hit your computer, Chris, and you have some more assurance that they're ready to hire.
Exactly.
Well, and just as a use case example, in the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences at University of Maryland, we have about 5,000 undergraduate students at any given time. And when we saw the generalist digital tech credential from the Greater Washington Partnership, we looked at this very detailed list and said, hey, you know what? A lot of our students in social sciences are ticking off all or most of these tools and skills that are identified by this group of employers. One group in particular, our government and politics and international relations majors, were really getting most of the data science, quantitative data visualization skills that these employers were looking for. There were only a few holes. So we were able, and we're just in the process of rolling this out now to our students, we were able to say to all of our government and politics majors, hey, do you realize you meet all the generalist, or almost all of the digital generalist tech credentials that the Greater Washington Partnership employers are looking for? All you need to do, in addition to doing your government and politics courses, is take one additional course or do these two additional online modules. And the areas where our government and politics major were not completely tying together were in data ethics and data privacy. And it's very interesting because the department faculty, when they looked at it, said, data ethics, we should be thinking about that. Maybe, you know, that's a hole that we really hadn't thought about as our curriculum has developed. So that's an example of the feedback loop. These are now students coming out with government and politics or international relations majors, and they will have this badge from the Greater Washington Partnership Capital CoLab, and they may stand out a little bit more because they don't have an engineering or computer science degree, but they can demonstrate to these employers that they have this set of skills. Now, we haven't completed a whole cycle. We're just pulling students into this program now. So a year from now, we should be able to tell you a little bit more how that's working. In addition to the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences, our College of Information Science, our College of Computer, Mathematical, and Natural Sciences are also starting to pull students in. And others on campus are interested as well. But that's where we are at that point. And I think, Alin, do you want to?
Well, I just to both of your points, I think it is that bridge, right, for students to be able to articulate that what I'm learning in the classroom is of value. And because there's so many great employer partners who've signed on, who've said, here are the exact skills, interests, and abilities that I need and want, they see themselves. I think so often we engage so many of the employers who are part of the GWP through traditional recruiting avenues, but to Chris's point, they look for certain students. And we know the depth and breadth of our social sciences students, those in the humanities, and this just gives them, I think, an additional layer of confidence to know that my skill set is kind of what is needed out in the marketplace moving forward.
Yeah, And I'm glad you shared that use case, Catherine, because I think it highlights one of the really important things we thought about at the onset of this program was that from an equity perspective, this can't be an additional set of courses students already taking on top of their very demanding curriculum. So as we bring on university partners, we give them the flexibility to deliver these KSAs and curriculum in a way that makes sense to them. So for some institutions, it's through a minor. Others, it's through a certificate. Others, it's through a series of elective courses that maybe make up a concentration. So we give them that flexibility to move faster, but also bring in more students who probably wouldn't have encountered these skills otherwise. So that's a really important piece of it and something we're really proud of.
If I could pull that thread a little bit more too, one thing that helps us as employers is we've actually worked with GWP to set up a series of micro internships. So that not only are the students getting the opportunity to take these tracks and to get this specific education or this badge, we're working with them to actually provide them short-term paid opportunities. So on the diversity front, on the socioeconomic front, or on just the opportunity for us to position ourselves with the CoLab students, we're providing pretty robust listing of micro internships now through a third party, where we can then take what they're learning in the classroom, but also augment that with some real work experiences, whether it's through additional research or whether it's through other open source related opportunities.
I think it just broadens the win, right? We know how diverse our student body is and that across the country. And so when we think about social capital and think students, first-generation students, our transfer students, to have the opportunity to do something like a micro internship to give them an opportunity to engage an employer short-term, paid, right, then gives them a leg up for the process moving on.
I just want to jump in here, and a couple of you have started on this, but we have each had the opportunity to work with our colleagues at a number of institutions across the DMV as we are having these conversations facilitated by the Greater Washington Partnership. And in the previous session, as we were listening, there are issues with when we're big R1 institutions, our students have access to a lot of resources, just as our faculty do as well. But at smaller institutions, that's not the case. And the Greater Washington Partnership, these programs are especially taking hold and seem to be working very well at some of our smaller institutions in the DMV. And I wonder if you could share a little bit more about how you feel this levels the playing field for students, both from smaller institutions and from backgrounds that are historically underrepresented in this pipeline.
Yeah, and there's so many factors that influence this, and we know one program won't solve for the universe of inequity in education and transferability into the workforce. But when we think about what we can control through this one program, it's really level setting the curriculum. So if we map knowledge, skills, and abilities to in-demand entry-level jobs and make sure that all of our partners have that same list or lists of KSAs, then we know that more institutions now are teaching toward the roles that we know are going to continue being in demand, and that makes students more competitive. So that's been important as we expand to non-R1 institutions, as we expand to HBCUs and MSIs. We at least know that we're factoring in curriculum and that students are learning the same things. And that's a benefit to our employer partners too, who through traditional campus recruiting may have only gone to one handful of institutions. We're broadening that aperture for them as they think about growing their talent pool.
And I'll just speak to the value of being able to partner across institutions, right, on this good work. We see many of the same employers. We know that so many of our students have the same issues or are trying to develop the same types of skills. So the opportunity to collaborate and brainstorm and provide students with those opportunities to connect to one another, right, as they're on this path, I think is a benefit as well. So we give you lots of credit for doing that on our behalf as well.
Maybe we have some questions for our audience that would spark some conversation as well. We move faster than you thought we would.
Thank you. Brian Darmy from AORP. I think this is a great program. You know, as a Maryland resident, I'm glad to see us working as a region. You know, we don't have a lot of history there, so I'm glad we came together. I guess this is maybe to the Career Center. So what's the incentive? I can understand with employers in the DMV, but if I'm a student and I get this credential, it's not going to be necessarily recognized if I am in California or whatever. What's the incentive for a student to, you know, be engaged with a credential that may not be universally recognized by other states or other employers outside of the DMV?
It's the process and the learning and the development that comes from the opportunity to engage with the high-level quality employers that are part of the CoLab. And while many of them sit in this region, they're not only in this region, right? And so they don't have to be bound geographically per se, though they may start here. And we know the value, again, of experiential learning and exposure. And so every opportunity matters to connect and build a relationship with a recruiter or an alum from a particular organization is part of a network that will carry them forward for years to come. But again, I think it's in the value of articulating the skills that I've learned in the classroom and had an opportunity to gain in the workforce that will take them wherever they go.
Yeah, if I can add to that, I'm part of an organization, the National Association of Colleges and Employers, and we built out career readiness competencies. And one of those is really around owning your career, basically. And I think it's a big gap that a lot of employers see that somebody comes into our company and they're like, okay, what do I do? Where do I go? What do you want me? And I think one of the key advantages of this is really, as you said, allowing the student to be able to articulate their skill set. Otherwise, many students, I know when I was a psychology major, we had to take a career course because we were all becoming shoe salesmen. And so we had to learn, this is a long time ago.
It's still true.
It was a long time ago. But I think this is allowing the student to have a better understanding of what skills they possess, how they can articulate it, and how it's relevant to employers. Whether or not it's the GWP badge is recognized by someone in California, the student can still go to California and say, well, let me tell you about this badge and what it symbolizes and the academic rigor I went through to earn this and the skills I'm bringing to you from a data visualization perspective or cybersecurity. So I think it's a critical way to help that student really be able to articulate themselves.
Hi, I'm Adrienne Vincent with the Council of Graduate Schools, and you're surfacing a lot of really interesting issues that we're talking about at the Council, both about micro-credentials, ensuring that employer needs are embedded in curriculum. But I'm interested in this digital badge program. It sounds like it's focused on undergraduate students. I'm wondering if you have plans or if there is a component of this for post-baccalaureate education and ensuring that master's students are able to obtain credentials that are signals to employers about their career readiness. And I'll just pause there and allow you to respond.
Yeah, so to date, our focus hasn't been post-baccalaureate at all because we're trying to build the pipeline starting earlier and making sure that students, especially those who are born here and grow up here and then maybe choose to go to school here, have access to the employment opportunities. So that's been our main focus so far, and I think will continue being our focus for the time being. Though we do know that especially in the DMV, we're realistic about how many jobs ask for a bachelor's or master's degree. So understanding that, but understanding we don't want to miss out an entire pool of potential workers, and we want to give them opportunities here. As we craft our programs, we really think about it in terms of a pathway with on-ramps and off-ramps to education and industry. So if a student completes their high school curriculum and they wanted to go on to college, we now, through our K-12 programs, have a target audience that we're working with to perhaps pitch a school like the University of Maryland who offers these credentials and then can provide guidance to post-baccalaureate. So we just, with that pathway approach, we think that offers us the most flexibility to impact the most amount of students. But I'd be interested in learning more just about that landscape since I'm not as familiar with it post-bac.
Thank you. So I'm Tinaz Pavri. I'm at Spelman College in Atlanta. And we've just come out of a at the end of a five-year grant-funded program, Career Pathways Initiative, where we really built the program around faculty involvement, because at a small liberal arts college like ours, nothing gets done without the faculty being intrinsically involved. So I would like to hear what ways, in your experience, have successfully been able to involve faculty and overcome maybe some innate resistance within the faculty body.
So I think when I work with a group of faculty who represent all of the departments in the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences, so that really runs the range of all of our disciplines in the college. And when I first said this coalition of employers, you know, has come to us, you kind of see this kind of behavior happen. And then we circulated the knowledge, skills, and abilities that the Greater Washington Partnership partners had put together. And I have to give the Capital CoLab a lot of credit. They actually wrote these KSAs in a way that the faculty might have written them themselves. They were not written with industry language. They really were written with more academic language. And they resonated with the faculty when they looked at them. And once they actually looked at the KSAs, they're like, oh, okay. The second thing is the Greater Washington Partnership did not ask us to change our curriculum. They did not ask us to create a minor. They did not ask us to create a certificate. All they said to us is, here's the list of things we really need for students to know and be able to do. Can you help us identify these students? And then the vehicle was, hey, this badging system might work best. It doesn't mess with your academic program at all. It's kind of running alongside it. And really, the faculty got on board. Especially in the social sciences, the disciplinary faculty are really eager to showcase that their students have these really marketable tools and skills. So it was not a hard sell at all. So thank you, that's a really excellent question.
I'd say, add quickly too, from an intermediary perspective, running this stuff, having a champion at each university has been really helpful. And then when it comes down to that KSA development or refresh process, we engage faculty or post-secondary facilitators to facilitate those industry groups. So they're playing a really active role in translating that language to a university audience.
Hi, good morning, everyone. My name is Jean McGloin. I'm the Associate Dean of Research in the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences here at Maryland. I have a question that's probably for all of you, but I'm going to direct it at Catherine because she's my colleague, so it's a comfortable space. We've alluded to this in different panels today, and you guys have talked around it, but the fact of the matter is that when it comes to business and academia, oftentimes they speak different languages, they're coming from a different motivational space, and those can be challenging conversations, they can be challenging partnerships. It's obviously worked very well in this space, and so my question is, why did it work? What was it? Was it a commitment of particular individuals who happened to work well together? Was it a common agreement around the principles that were working here? But what are some lessons learned in terms of how can people do this in spaces where maybe they're starting from scratch?
I can kick us off, and then if you want to jump in. So I'd say three things that were really key for us. First was having senior leadership buy-in. I think if we hadn't had that luncheon or gathering of CEOs and university presidents to all come to consensus about what the critical skills needs were and talent needs and how we could all work together more to create it, I'm not sure we would have had the impact as fast as we did. So senior leadership buy-in, I think, was critical. The second thing was promoting that flexibility in terms of curriculum that you talked about, Catherine, too. So as we bring on partners, trusting them to incorporate these KSAs in a way that works and makes sense for their institution and for their student body was really important. And then I think third, just having a continuous improvement mindset around all of this. As we formalized our work, we make sure that we're working with the right people on the academic side and on the employer side to keep this moving. So it isn't just a conversation, we actually can implement on it. So that means we have quarterly career center meetings to reach students better. It means we have meetings with our University Leadership Council, also quarterly, to gut check how this is working, if there's something that's missing and this isn't getting to students or students aren't getting to employers, and we just keep improving it. It was never set up as a one and done program. It's something that we're committing to.
I think the only thing I would add is probably the impetus at the beginning when this came about. It was clearly articulated what the burning platform was. The CEO of Northrop Grumman, the CEO of these other companies, bringing public sector people into the mix, bringing academia into the mix, really articulating what that burning platform was. And it was an urgency within the DMV, really, to have something like this in order for us to sustain our employers, to ensure that our academics are up to, the highest standards possible to continue it. So I think part of it is, to add to what you just said, was just making sure that that burning platform is fully articulated and everyone buys into that.
And I would just add, in communicating internally, our colleagues, at least at the University of Maryland, our colleagues at the University of Career Center several years ago started really pushing the NACE graduation survey. And so all the students at University of Maryland are asked to report on what they're doing, and then our University Career Center provides us with all the data by unit, cross-checks it with the clearinghouse for where students are going to grad school, internet stalks the students to try to find where they're going even if they haven't reported to us, and gives us pretty good data on where our graduating seniors are going. And then when we show that to our faculty and department chairs, look, 3 to 5% of your students went to a PhD program. Look, 30% of your students went to a master's program. The other 65 to 70% of them went and got a job last year, and here's what they're saying about the kind of jobs they got. It's like, oh yeah, okay, we need to pay attention to this, because this is where the vast majority of our students are headed. Many of them will pursue more education after that, but more students are going directly into the workforce than not from our social sciences majors at University of Maryland, just as one example. The data speak for itself.
Yeah, and I just echo everything that's been said. I think CoLab brought all the right players together and gave everyone a voice in the process, which mattered. And I think on the student side, didn't create extra work, and the employers were already there saying, this is what we want. We're waiting for you on the other end, right? There are lots of credentials and badges out there, but they don't have that stamp of approval from the folks on the other end that really matter to students. And so they've done a great job of creating those incentives and providing opportunities to connect along the way, right, before I get to the end and maybe have an opportunity to actually end up with an opportunity.
Hi, this is super fascinating. I'm loving all of the conversation. One of the questions I had, and just by introduction, my name is Melissa Bott. I'm a sociologist working in Silicon Valley. And I'm like, this is the complete opposite of what I see on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. I have so many thoughts. But my question for you today is, as I'm hearing you talk, one of the things I'm thinking about is, what about local employers, right? Because when we started the conversation, you're like, what I'm hearing is, we want Amazon to be in the DMV because we want that money. Like, I'm just... And I appreciate that. But what about local employers? How are you partnering with local employers? And what are the relationships between the companies you want to bring in versus the ones that are already here?
Well, that I'm a local employer.
Yeah.
Hey, albeit national. We had a major headquarters here, as well as some major facilities in and around this area. So it's an area of tremendous growth for us. So part of it was a concern. You know, how are we going to continue to see growth in our area, maintain the pipeline of skilled talent, and still be successful and maintain our growth numbers? So local employers, I think everyone in CoLab has very large facilities between Richmond and Baltimore, such that if we did add that additional new person, that new company into the mix, we were concerned, how do we maintain our footprint in this area and still remain successful? So I don't.
Yeah, and building on that further, so while our direct membership at Greater Washington Partnership is the largest employers in the region, we do have opportunities and make sure that we engage small and medium-sized businesses throughout. And one of the direct ways we do that through the CoLab is in that employer signaling process, those industry advisor groups we run every year. We don't limit involvement in that to only our members because we don't want to miss out on the needs of small and medium-sized businesses, and we also don't want to over-index on the DMV if there are small businesses in Baltimore or Richmond who want to be at the table for that. So we're really welcome and seek them out as part of the process to make sure that the skills, knowledge, skills, abilities that universities end up with represent a wide spread of employers in the region.
Good morning, Nick Miller from University of Michigan. I'm curious, I know we've talked about this mainly from a talent perspective, but I occupy a corporate relations role and often see engagements on the talent side happen to be kind of a springboard between academic, larger academic and industrial partnerships. I know it's a newer effort, but just curious if kind of Northrop Grumman or Maryland, you know, have kind of seen that or are working toward that, or if you view that as kind of a potential outcome, you know, just as a further growth effort beyond kind of a talent, just from a talent perspective.
I'm not sure I understand the question.
So I apologize. I guess in my experience, if companies are coming recruiting students, these often kind of lead into springboards for other things like sponsored projects, work with faculty, capstone projects, those types of things. I'm just curious if there have been any case studies yet. Again, I know it's an early effort, but just curious if Northrop Grumman is seeing that kind of an effort moving toward, hey, we have a, you know, an engagement now with several universities. Are we looking at blowing up this partnership into something really large, really strategic, or if that's not kind of the goal, just kind of curious how, both from an industrial and an academic perspective, what the, if there's a broader goal there.
I think for us, it, obviously it is a primary driver from a talent perspective, but I think one of the things that we have started to see is a growth within those micro internships. Most of the time, our micro internships, because they're open source or because they're kind of in a support organization, it may not be our traditional, let's go build an airplane. It might be something more that we may not have normally looked for. So from our perspective, one of the benefits we're seeing is not only a better collaborative engagement with the universities that are part of that CoLab, but it also affords us the opportunity to start to engage students that we typically wouldn't engage with, and providing them work assignments and letting us see the end result of what they can actually produce and achieve as part of that process, and why they could become a great talent source for us. And then with the regular meetings that we have, it gives us an opportunity to engage in a scalable and sustainable way with a larger number of universities. You know, Chris can't go everywhere, and you know, Chris can't touch 21 universities in the greater Washington area, even with our team of, you know, we have recruiters all over the place, but even that, we're limited. So this actually gives us a broader opportunity to have greater conversations, to explore, again, other opportunities to reach those students that normally we may not be able to actually engage. And that does springboard into other things. It springboards into more initiatives with the Greater Washington Partnership. It can springboard into, you know, here's some capstone ideas and things of that nature. So yes, I think I answered.
I wouldn't propose to speak for the university, but on behalf of the College of Behavioral and Social Sciences, I think if we get the pipeline rolling, it may be that some more of the employers will talk to us, because they'll realize that our students have they'll see a pattern of our students having the skills and knowledge, and we'll have more of our students who are employed earlier at some of these companies. We have built relationships with some of the larger companies in our community and some of the smaller companies in our community, and that's often through alumni or through individual students or faculty members who make those connections. I think this is another way to just grow those relationships over time. So you raise an interesting series of opportunities for our future, but we're not quite there yet.
Brian Darby, I was head of corporate relations for the University of Maryland many years ago. And actually, I think Wes Bush, who was the CEO mm-hmm. of Northrop, we had a very strong partnership called ACES, the Advanced Computer mm-hmm. Cybersecurity Experience for Students. Mm-hmm. But it was very restricted just to the top engineering and computer science students. And this is before Greater Washington Partnership was even formed. And he, loved the program. He visited a campus, I think, three times, the CEO of this top 100 corporation. But I think that he started having conversations about how do we expand this. And then you can explain how the Greater Washington Partnership was formed. But I think it was actually we had the corporate relations, but he wanted to see it broader. And some of that conversation, I think, led mm-hmm. to the formation of the Greater Washington Partnership. Yeah.
My name is Mercy Shengi from the Department of Applied Social and Political Sciences at Coppin State University. I remember when Lindsay Johnson was talking, she spoke about e-school having a champion, that helps. So what of schools that don't have champions? Is there any process, that schools can take to have like a champion in their school?
Yeah, I mean, I'd defer to someone in academia to answer that better than me since I'm not in the inside. But again, going back to the initial kickoff CoLab meeting, I think having a university president at the table was a very key piece to enabling those champions down the road. So without that, I would definitely have to defer to someone in the academic system to rely on them. But we do convene quarterly those university partners, and through those regular meetings, we can surface ways of better reaching our partners, and that's just one way we think about it. I don't know if you have any.
Yeah, I don't know what the history of the outreach was, but there are a number of quite small universities in Maryland are involved. I'm not sure if Coppin is or not, but I'm sure that's possible.
So we've got time for one more question. Does anyone else have any other questions?
So one other question I had is this notion of reskilling, sort of mid-career, and I'm curious to know how that factors into this credential. Is it, I understand that it's primarily for undergraduates, but what are you seeing from potentially folks who may have gotten an undergraduate degree in one discipline and are using a micro-credential to reskill, mid-career?
Yeah, from my seat, I haven't seen that as much, but I know it's something that's happening. So what I'll say about it is I know it's on the horizon. We talk about upskilling and reskilling a lot, but currently the digital tech credential is embedded into undergraduate curriculum, so it isn't anything like separate outside of that. That's not to say we couldn't move that direction in the future, but this is the approach we're testing out now. What I do know, though, is that many of our university partners serve non-traditional student populations. So I think about Virginia Commonwealth University is one of them. Many of their returning undergraduates are adult learners. And so that's just part of their process going back and achieving a degree. But upskilling, reskilling is really important. I know a lot of employers came to the table because they had that on their minds as well. And so it's something we're always thinking about. We haven't landed on a scalable solution for that yet. And we're not sure that we'll be the ones who can provide that, but if we can usher a greater relationship with the many amazing academic institutions in the region to perhaps address a need for one employer, then that's a win.
Yeah, and forgive me, last night I actually cheated and looked again through all the coursework and all the departments and all the schools just to make sure I wasn't, going to say something stupid. But I've noticed that we have a lot of courses aligned to schools of continuous education.
Yeah.
So I know that that's part of it. So I know that there's been universities that have embedded it into their non-traditional pipeline as well.
Yeah.
Hopefully I'm not speaking
it. Nope, you're right. Okay. Glad
I looked
right.
that up.
And thank you. Well, thank you very much, panelists. Really appreciate your being here. Thanks to our organizer, Ted Knight, to UIDP for having us, and Capital CoLab and Greater Washington Partnership both have very robust, interesting websites. They list all the employers, all the universities, lots of context. So I encourage you to take a look. Thanks very much.
Thank you.